there have been no less than five situations where I've been out with my family where I've pulled my knife from my pocket and had it in my hand closed in case something happens. Listen, I mean, it's your family. That's the most valuable thing you have, right? I always have my knife on me.
Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, your weekly dose of knife news and information about knives and knife collecting. Here's your hosts, Jim Person and Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco.
Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast. I'm Jim Person.
And I'm Bob DeMarco from TheKnifeJunkie.com.
Welcome to episode number 21 of the Knife Junkie Podcast. And Bob, a little different interview for us this time, but I was fascinated listening to the interview that you had with your buddy, your friend, but also a Marine Scout Sniper, and just some of the stories he told in the interview. I was really interested in hearing it, so I think our listeners will too.
Yeah, I've always loved to hear people's experiences out in the tactical world. I don't know how else to say it. I love listening to people's war stories. I love to talk to people who have used knives in the field, who have a different relationship with knives than I do. I have this obsessive collection kind of fetish thing, and there are actual people out there who use their knives on a daily basis and in real situations. Whether they're carpenters or scout snipers, martial artists or linesmen. So yeah, I thought this was a great conversation, and frankly, in the years I've known him, I feel like we just had the most concentrated conversation on this particular topic right now, and so I'm really happy we grabbed it.
All right. Well, didn't you use your knife at work yesterday to open a box? I mean, come on.
No, I used my knife to cut my sandwich, Jim.
Well, there you go, manly thing.
And boy, did that sandwich scream!
It tasted great too. It was. Left some patina on that knife as well. So.
Why do you think I use it? Yep.
That's right. Hey, just want to remind everybody, today's podcast is brought to you by Audible. You can get a free audiobook download and a 30-day free trial if you go to audibletrial.com/knifejunkie. Over 180,000 titles to choose from for your iPhone, Android, Kindle, or MP3 player. Again, that's audibletrial.com/knifejunkie.
Do you carry multiple knives, then overthink which one to use when an actual cutting chore pops up? You're a knife junkie of the first order.
Here on the Knife Junkie Podcast, we like to talk to folks that make knives, people that review knives, and professionals whose jobs give them a unique perspective on knives and their uses. Today, I'm speaking with friend and former Marine Drew Swift. Drew spent his 8.5 years in the Marine Corps as a high-value target in a specialized role, one in which self-reliance, a cool head, staggering endurance, and mental discipline were critical, not only to success, but to survival. Drew has a unique military perspective on the importance of being able to rely on your equipment when it matters most, but I'll let him tell you all about that. Let's just say Drew's the kind of guy you want on your side when it's going down, whether it's in the battle space or in the back alley. Drew, thank you for your service, and welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast.
Hey, thanks for having me.
My pleasure. So let's start off with a pocket check. What are you carrying? I know you got a knife on you. What is it?
I've got my Benchmade on me, as a matter of fact.
Your Benchmade 940.
That's correct.
Okay. Yeah, I know that's your that's been your favorite.
That's my walk-along.
Your walk-along. It seems like law enforcement and military guys just love their Benchmades.
You know, they're reliable, man. It's never, ever done me wrong.
Yeah, I've been carrying my my bug out today. Because okay. I've been doing some chores, and that little sucker is light and strong. And so that's what I've been rolling with today. Usually I have a bunch of knives on me and a lot bigger than that, you know, because that's how I roll. But not today.
Yeah, I'm about to feel naked. I'm getting on a plane today, and I know they're not going to let me bring it. So I'm trying to figure out what I'm going to do when I get on the deck.
Yeah, you know they're going to palm that sucker if you try to bring it anywhere close. Okay, so I just want to lay down a caveat. I'm not a military man, never was. And so my questions may sound naive, but it's out of genuine ignorance and out of legitimate curiosity. So if you hear some things that sound a little crazy to you, that's where it's coming from. First of all, let me ask you, were you always a knife guy? And if so, what's your favorite blade type?
Tanto. I love the Tanto blade. I don't know why. It might just be the look. It may just be that it's sexy. It may just be that it's practical as all hell for its purpose, but I love a Tanto blade. I always have. I'm a sucker.
So were you always carrying knives like when you were a young guy?
I got my very, very first pocket knife, and it was just a regular old school late 50s, early 60s open extendable pocket knife. It was made by Buck. It was a Buck knife, and it was awesome. And I got it when I was 11 years old, and I joined the Cub Scouts. And when I was a scout, that was the first present that I had. Welcome to scouting. It's time to learn to do grown-up stuff. And I got a Buck knife, pocket knife. And I've probably carried a knife at some point just about throughout all of my history since.
So that was no doubt a Buck 110 if it was a folding locking knife.
No doubt.
And man, that is a sweet first knife. I got a lot of hand-me-downs from my grandpa, which have a lot of sentimental value, but not the capability of a Buck 110. Still, you know, that was the first folding locking knife that really changed everything. And you know, a lot of people now talk about tactical knives like my ZTs and my Cold Steels, but that was the first redneck tactical knife. You know what I'm saying? Everyone had one.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And even though it didn't have G10 and fancy materials, I'm sure that got in a couple of bar fights now and again.
I have actually been blessed to never have to pull a damn knife in a bar fight.
Thank God. Well, yes. Tell us about your military service. What were your job functions and where were you deployed?
I started my career. I spent 6.5 years with 3rd Battalion, 8th Marines and 2nd Marine Division stationed out of North Carolina down at Camp Lejeune. And then my last two and a half years, I was stationed at Quantico as an instructor at the basic school. The basic school is a school, a 6-month-long program for Marine officers. They go after their officer candidate school. When Marine officers graduate OCS, they do so as, you know, basically trained officers. Sending them to the basic school makes them a basically trained Marine officer. While I was stationed at Quantico at the basic school, I was an instructor at the close combat course where I held the billet of a close combat instructor trainer. That basically means that I teach people how to teach people close combat. Before that, I started my career as a squad automatic rifleman in 3rd Battalion, 8th Marines, Kilo Company. I did my first deployment to the Mediterranean in 1995, where we participated in Operation Deny Flight over, at the time, was Bosnia Herzegovina, I think it is. Our battalion also was the primary, what they call TRAP team. TRAP stands for Tactical Recovery of Aircraft Personnel. So a very famous guy, Scott O'Grady. Do you remember that name?
I do.
Yeah, he was a pilot for an F-16 that got shot down over Bosnia. Funny, actually, Hollywood made a movie called, I forget the name of the movie, but with...
Behind Enemy Lines.
Yeah, with, what's his name?
Owen Wilson.
Owen Wilson, thank you, and Gene Hackman. That movie was actually made about that story of Tom O'Grady. But my battalion was actually the tactical recovery of aircraft personnel team that went in and got them out. So that was also on that deployment. But at that time, I was what's called a squad automatic rifleman. So I carried the M249 SAW.
That's a big machine gun, right?
It's not a big machine gun. It's actually a lightweight, shoulder-fed, gas-operated machine gun. Mm-hmm. It shoots a standard NATO 223 ball round. But it can do so with the cyclic rate of about 2,000 rounds a minute.
Damn.
You're never going to be able to do that. You'll never feed that much ammo into that weapon without it jamming.
Right.
But that was my first principal billet. When I got out of that, I ran a scout sniper team NDOC and joined the scout sniper platoon for 3rd Battalion, 8th Marines. And I served in every billet there from radio operator up to section leader by the time that I was done. When I finished there, I was the section leader for the black side team that we had. We had three sections at the time, black, blue, and green. Green, obviously, being, you know, out in the bush, black being urban environment, and blue being waterborne. So we had a section designated to operations for all three that we would specialize in. All of us could obviously do missions in all three components, but each section specialized in one, and I was in charge of black, so urban ops.
Was that once you were a scout sniper?
Yeah, that was once I was in the platoon.
Okay, I'm going to get to that in a second. I'm very okay. interested in hearing about what a scout sniper does and what it's like to go on a mission and to prepare for a mission. But before we go there, you are a close combat instructor trainer. What does that entail? I assume that's hand-to-hand combat, martial artsy kind of stuff.
That is absolutely. So the Marine Corps actually changed from what used to be called line training. And it had a cute little, you know, line is an acronym for a cute little name that they gave it, which is linear infighting neurological engagement. And it basically means we are going to combat each other in a linear manner. And it's going to be close infighting. And it's basically the neural overriding engagement means break things so bad that your brain won't be able to think its way out of it. Blunt force trauma in every humanly way possible. And I was actually a close combat instructor for that system of training that the Marine Corps had. And then the Marine Corps decided to switch over to something that they wanted to call MCMAP, which was the Marine Corps Martial Arts Program. That became a project of a guy called Master Gunnery Sergeant Urso, and his primary assistant was a guy named Master Gunnery Sergeant Polzin, which are two of the people that I trained under like directly. In the process, they basically took aspects of every martial arts program that they'd all ever been a part of. They took what works, and they just shit-canned the rest. And you also have to understand that all of this martial arts training is already being applied to people who have a warrior's ethos and a warrior's mindset. So the make sure your foot's here and you pivot this way and bow to somebody before you smack them in the mouth is removed. And it's very much, hey, you want to kill this dude? In their face, go get him. You know, that's what it is. It's none of the niceties, and it's all of the violence. They have a mindset, or they have a, you know, they have a little mantra there that is one mind, any weapon. And it's very much the core of what they do. It's your mind, and you need to be able to look at everything as a weapon. And as long as nobody can bring violence and intensity to the fight the way that you do, you're going to be the one that's a victor.
That came into real sharp relief about 10 years ago. You and I were kind of messing around on something. And I was showing you some of the rather flowery self-perfection kind of techniques I was learning from Kali. Beautiful stuff to train your attributes, you know, your speed, your timing, your flow and all that stuff, but not the kind of stuff you actually want to fight with. And I didn't understand that quite then. And I was like, hey, Drew, check this out. Check this out. And you're like, so I was showing you these flowery, twirly, cool moves with a knife. And I remember you kind of just grabbing the knife out of my hands and then pretending to crush my skull. And I remember thinking, oh, there's a lot more for me to learn. I have this flow. I have this self-perfection thing down. But what about the self-preservation side? And that's when I just started training in a system where they were addressing both of those things. But your close combat from the Marine Corps really painted that picture for me. Like, this has so much more to do with what's inside between the ears than it does the kind of trained movements I have. You know, you have the warrior's ethos.
Sure. And, you know, this directly relates into fighting with a knife very specifically. It's, you know, people have these different misconceptions, possibly from not knowing, being uneducated, possibly from being misrepresented through the media or what have you. You know, about how to fight with the knife and how it needs to be this and pretty and that. You know what? It's not pretty. There's nothing pretty about it. And I'm going to tell you right now, our rule, the first thing that you understand going in a knife fight, you're going to get cut. Even if it's you cutting yourself, you're going to get cut. So like, if you're going into a knife fight worrying about not getting cut, you've already lost. You know, just like your mind is in the wrong place. You need to get 3 steps past that and be on the aggressive side of things.
I had an instructor once who said the only person who wins a knife fight is the guy who dies second, which I kind of
that's a good way to put that.
So let's go on to your scout sniping days. First of all, there is the scout and there is the sniper. What is the difference between them? Are they the same thing?
It's two roles of the same job. What I would say is this. Any scout sniper on the planet is probably 90% more scout than they are sniper.
So what does that mean, scouting?
Okay, it means exactly that. Long-range reconnaissance and eyeballs. The beauty about a scout sniper team, whether it be a 2-man team, whether it be a 4-man team, whether it be a 13-person section, you know, the beauty of all of it is that at their lowest kind of denomination, it's a 2-man team that's a set of eyeballs, a set of ears out for the commander in a forward position. The thing you got to realize is this. No sniper, like, you've got to be in a oh shit situation. Like, have you seen, you've seen Band of Brothers, right?
Yes.
Okay. You've also seen Saving Private Ryan, right?
Sure.
Okay. Both of those shows / movies have scenes where there is a classically trained redneck World War II, like Southern guy with a Winchester 700 in a bell tower somewhere taking like 80 shots at somebody, suppressing them. Right.
Right.
Hey, I'm going to stand in the highest building that's the most identifiable, and I'm going to start shooting from the same place over and over again. Please aim tank here, right? Yeah. A scout sniper is never going to take a shot, the second shot from the same place. Not if they want to live and not if they want to get away. The only time you ever do that is if you have no other choice and like your boys downrange are dying. That's the only time you would ever do that, right? So 90% of the time, you're going to be more scout than you will be sniper. You're going to be a set of eyeballs. You're going to be that, you know, that voice to back to the commander to let them see through your eyes, troop movements, hardened emplacements, battle lines, what kind of, you know, rear logistics somebody has. You know, Carlos Hathcock is the Marines' most decorated sniper. I don't think he still has the most kills. I don't know. But even if he doesn't, he did it before anybody else. And he did it in a manner that nobody else had ever seen before.
Was he in Vietnam?
He was.
Okay, I've heard
he was. He has a recorded kill of over half a mile, when half a mile is, you know, you're talking at that point, that's roughly 900 yards. And he did it with like a 50 cal M2.
Wow.
Yeah. He put a scope. It's crazy. He's
the big machine gun with the two.
That's correct. With a butterfly. That's correct. And he scoped it and nailed it, apparently.
Wow.
You know, and there's a lot of lore behind that. And I'm sure, you know, it could have been 150 yards, you know, from his hip backwards.
Yeah, right.
You know, that's the way the Marine Corps works. But that's, you know, the primary responsibility of that position is to be that forward set of eyes. So you can have eyeballs on the enemy before they even know you're there.
Okay, so paint a picture for us. You're going out into the field. You're scoping out a position or a target. And it's mostly about reconnaissance, mostly about observation. And then you take one shot from that position to move on and what have you. But tell me a little bit about the digging in process and the, you know, are you laying there for a long time? Are you using shovels to clear a spot? And are you using your machete to cut down foliage to put around you? Like, paint a picture of what it's like actually being out there scoping things out.
The only time you would ever do something like that is if you're in a defensive position. So defensive positions are hardened positions. We own this tactical piece of land and we want to keep it. We want to retain it. So we're going to fortify it. That's when you start building hides. That's when you would get in and, you know, with an E-tool, which is also an amazing straight edge weapon that should be considered a knife. But that's when you would like get in there and dig out a hide and camouflage it and make it seem like no one would ever see it. You never know it's there, but you've got a great field of vision and a great field of fire. When you're on an offensive side of things, when you're out there, you know, not necessarily protecting, you know, the camp or the base or the fob or whatever it is, you want to leave as little target indicators as humanly possible.
Right.
You don't ever want somebody to know that you were there. And so you're looking at scratch hides. You'll probably be in a ghillie suit, which kind of negates the need for digging in a hide because it allows you to use the natural camouflage around you. In urban environments, you know, it's a lot more of, you know, a lot of snipers carry things in their pack like drop cloths that are spray painted different colors, mesh and screening that have been spray painted with different grays and blacks and like a color palette. I know snipers who carry, you know, almost like open their field coat and here are six small cans of spray paint inside of it. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, you know the field of environment that you're going to be operating in, and that's part of your mission prep is to make sure that you have the things that you're going to need to be able to handle the environment that you're in. Mm-hmm. And obviously, like everything else, you got to be able to think on your feet and adapt and overcome.
Yeah, yeah. So you're out there, you have the longest range handheld weapon, you know, barring, not bazookas, but, you know, barring man-carried missile launches.
Sure.
You've got a long range rifle, but you also have a knife. First of all, have you ever heard of a knife being used in combat other than for opening MREs or something like that? I mean, as a weapon.
Sure. Absolutely. All the time.
Really? So I have this image of guys coming up behind people and, you know, cutting the throat, sentry removal, just like I've seen in the movies. But I feel like that can't be this day and age with silenced weapons and stuff like that. I can't imagine that's being done. Is that being done?
No, I mean, you never know. It could be, but it's not World War II anymore. We're not like sneaking up on Jerry and trying to, you know, stick a knife in the back of his neck and hold his mouth closed while he's doing it. Like, you're right, that doesn't happen as much. Let me give you some practical app. Room cleaning, dude. Room clearing, coming into a room. If you stack on a door, you know, you guys enter a house and all of a sudden in goes a flashbang, in goes a flashbang, boom, boom, you're through the door. As long as everything goes right, you know, you're in there with an M4, you come around the corner, engage, your weapon jams, you drop it, you pull your pistol. You only have 9 rounds. You know, if you go through those 9 rounds and there's 10 people, you might need to pull that knife. You know, you're not going to have time to think. You're just going to keep charging. And it's not like it's 1, 2, 3 steps. Stop, raise my rifle, shoot, jam. Oh, no. Secondary action. 1, 2, 3. Shoot these rounds. Take 2 more steps. It's not like that. It's you're going to take 11 steps towards your targets. And the first 2 is going to be your shooting. The second 3 is going to be your pistol. And then the last one is going to be that knife. You know, it's all going to be fluid. It's all going to be faster than anybody can react to it. And it all needs to be second nature to you. You don't like, right. You can't think in those environments. You just do. If you think, you die.
Right. Okay. SEER training. You did SEER training. I'm assuming that's probably your bread and butter when you're a sniper. Survival, evasion, resistance, and escape. So what role of the knife in that? And tell me a little bit about how you're trained. I mean, what you can tell me about SEER training.
It's exactly what it is. In the same breath that I said, you know, understand that if you go into a knife fight, you're going to get cut. You need to understand that before you go in. They teach you the same thing in a lot of ways. It's, you know, in SEER school, you're going to get caught. Just be ready to be caught. A lot of it, you know, there is a lot of technique, you know, about how to evade, how to resist, how to escape, how to do these things, how to survive on your own. It's how to trap animals, how to prepare a trap, how to look at the environment that you're on and think about ways that might be beneficial for you to escape. Oh, here's a waterway that runs out this direction. You know, definitely use the water because it's going to help you mask animals. Maybe don't go downstream. Maybe go against the current and go upstream because everybody's going to think that you're going to try and float downstream. You know, there's a lot of different things like that, you know, have the mind of escaping. if you can escape with a knife, that's like saying, you know, hey, here's the key to the car. All you have to do is make sure you get gas because it's going to run out of gas in 20 miles. Yeah, okay, I'll find a place to steal some gas. Thank you for the car. You know, that's a knife in a survival situation. Like, wait, I can have this knife that'll help me kill, that's going to help me create a weapon, that's going to help me build a shelter, that's going to help me hammer in a nail if I need to, like anything, you know, that's going to get me fire when I need it. You know, all of these things you can do with a straight edge weapon if you have one.
The beauty part is this is you have, especially as a modern United States Marine, you are laden with sophisticated equipment, and yet probably the most valuable thing you could have in a survival, evasion, resistance, and escape situation is the oldest tool ever created, you know, a knife.
One of them.
Yeah. And it is the most, and a compass, I bet that helps too.
For sure.
But I mean, it is the original multi-tool, you know, that single blade.
Sure. Let me ask you this. If I asked you to come pick me up at my house right now, could you?
Sure.
Yeah. Would you know how to get here by yourself?
Yeah.
Or would you have to use Google Maps?
I could get to your house, but yeah, point taken. I would use Google Maps.
Okay. Well, guess what? What happens when Google Maps breaks? You luckily know how to get to my house, right?
Right.
And if you didn't, you're old enough where you know how to read a map and get here.
That's right.
What happens when my slick ass piece of whatever gear I'm working right now doesn't work? Am I going to throw a projectile at a combatant? Yeah, that'll work until they get to me. Like, you know, you can't fall back on skills you don't possess. You need to be able to have things that work in an analog world.
Agreed. This is something we should spread far and wide to these youngsters with their heads buried in their phones. Okay, I'm not that old, but...
Yeah, right.
But for
wait a minute, dude, I'm using my iPhone. I'm keeping that.
Yeah, right, exactly. Well, we were recently talking about how I read a news story where young folks today, listen to me, I sound like my grandfather, young people today don't really know how to read maps. They just know how to turn left when their device tells them to turn left. They know to go straight when their device tells them to turn straight. So, you know, to that end, everyone should be at least a little prepared. I'm not saying be paranoid because that doesn't help anybody. And that makes life not so pleasant to live. But we should all have some amount of preparation, maybe some little bit of food stored up in the house just in case you lose your job or whatever. A survival kit in the car in case you break down and you have to do some hiking. What do you think people should have in their personal survival kits?
In a personal survival kit?
Yeah.
Without question, for me personally, there are four items that you just can't do without. And that's a knife, string, or 550 cord or fishing line of some sort, like some sort of string, a knife, water filtration or some means to like filter water and use whatever type of water that you can, and some sort of space blanket to keep you warm / give you shelter somewhere if you need it. You need to be able to keep yourself warm. You need to be able to keep yourself hydrated. You need to be, and you need a knife, obviously, because that'll help get you food. And then a flint, something to get you fire. You need fire, shelter, warmth, and hydration. Those four things, you can survive.
So start with those and then balloon out into your fancy other gear.
Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, what are we talking about? Are we talking about really surviving? Because if you're talking about really surviving, the shit's not fancy. If you're talking like, I need to survive this weekend sleeping in the back of the car with my wife and kids out at the campground, yeah, man, then get fancy. Get a LED cooler, have LED lights. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, totally.
Well, in my job, I'm always helping inform the public about make a kit and stay informed and, you know, be prepared. Because
for sure.
Because emergency services, if there is a legitimate emergency, will not be able to get to most people and in any sort of timely manner.
And something I know that I don't need to tell you, but I'll say it for the benefit of your listeners, Bob and I both agree on this. One other thing that's imperative to everything else is a plan. You need to have a plan before something happens, not once something happens.
Yes, sir. And maybe even a backup plan would help.
Backup plans are part of the process. You know, that's when I say have a plan, I mean three plans.
Right. So how have you carried your warrior ethos into your life after your time in the Marine Corps?
It's a thing that actually probably gets me called an old fuddy-duddy or, you know, just, oh, you don't know, you're just an old man, whatever. Like, I look at things differently. And kids today, you know, you say that, you know, the young people and this, that, and the other. People have always said that about younger kids, you know, when they get to be every age along the way. You know, it's like, at some point, it's like, oh, well, they're just too old and they don't understand. And then when you get our age, it's like, oh, wow, that's what they meant when they said this. You know what I mean? So that is what that is. But I look at things differently. I look at the world a little bit differently than people do. Part of that ethos is, you know, as a man, you walk around and, you know, at the essence of old school masculinity and just the reality is, you know, there used to be a time when you were judged on your ability to stand your piece of ground and how you were going to stand on your piece of ground. That's not lost to some people. If it comes down to the end, you know, or it gets into a situation where, oh, this technology isn't going to do it for you. This isn't going to do this for you. And it's going to come back to, can you hold your piece of ground? Yes, I can. Can you? You know what I mean? Like, so it's, I don't know. I mean, I think that's where I keep it, is just knowing that I need, you know, and Bob, you and I know each other, and you know, I've been through a little bit of a journey recently. I'm going to tell you right now, in the journey that I've been on to get myself back to the best version of me lately, damn it, I still want to be dangerous, and I still want to be able to be dangerous, because the day that I stop being dangerous is this day that people stop taking me that way.
Well, you know, Jordan Peterson, who I'm pretty sure you're familiar with.
Somewhat.
Talks about how he talks about the old Bible verse, the meek will inherit the earth. And he did a lot of research on that, and he discovered that in translation over the years from Greek and whatnot, meek was never intended to mean weak and mild. Meek was intended to mean those who carry swords and know how to use them and are monsters, but choose not to use them and not to be monsters unless absolutely necessary. And to me, that really resonates. Having that ability within you is the important part. Not being a monster.
And using it.
Yeah, exactly.
You know what? The happiest warrior ever is the person who's trained every day of his life to do one thing and then never has to do it.
Amen. Well, on that note, do you have any stories, knife stories, story from the field? It could be, I know you've told me some stories from just living in the urban environment you live in.
Sure.
I'd like to wrap up with a knife story. Anything?
I'll be very honest with you. Most of the like knife stories that I have are of jarheads being in the field and having downtime. Like, it's all romantic. Oh, we're out in the field and we're doing this. 90% of the time that you're ever in the field, it's downtime, like waiting to do something stupid, you know, for something stupid. Right. And all of those knife stories are like, hey, see if we can stick this knife in a tree that's right next to, you know, Jones over there and scare him. Like, we used to do stupid shit with knives that you probably should not do. The whole put your hand on a board game and try and get in between your fingers.
Yeah, like aliens.
I've seen too many people get cut that way. Like, I've seen, oh, throw a knife at their feet and, oh, dude, are you okay? You know, like, just dumb things. I've seen people cut themselves. But, like, I wish I had, like, some super cool story of how somebody came charging in with a knife and saved the day. But I don't.
You know, I have a lot of – all of my knife stories are me cutting myself.
Yeah, for sure.
Stabbing myself, trying to impress a girl, whatever it is. But I recall not too long ago you telling me about how you were being – you and your family were being menaced. And when words didn't work, your thought was – I mean, you didn't – thank God you didn't have to go there. But your thought was, I got my benchmate on me. Do you remember what I'm talking about, Drew?
I don't remember the specific reason, because that has happened to me more than once. At one point, like, we used to live a block from an inner city metro station, and my backyard used to constantly have people who were in some different state of OD, some different state of being shady, like some different state of being nefarious happening in, you know, my alley behind me all the time. And there have been no less than five situations where I've been out with my family where I've pulled my knife from my pocket and had it in my hand closed in case something happens. Listen, I mean, it's your family. That's the most valuable thing you have, right?
Amen.
You know, I always have my knife on me.
Well, Drew Swift, on that note, I think
except for the airport.
Yeah, that's where they like to unman you. Yeah, they just break you down.
That's all right. I don't need it.
You got your hands.
There it is.
All righty, my man. Well, it was a pleasure talking with you about this stuff. And, you know, again, thanks for your service. I was thinking while you were doing what you were doing, I was studying art. What a radically different contrast there. But I'm so glad I know you, and I'm so glad there are people like you out there on the line, as they say. Yeah. And thanks for coming on the Knife Junkie Podcast.
It's my pleasure, Bob.
Subscribe to the Knife Junkie's YouTube channel at theknifejunkie.com/YouTube.
All right, Bob, a lot of cool little one-liners and kind of things I was writing down as Drew was talking, you know, one mind, any weapon. I love that kind of thought, you know, when he was talking about the survival kit, you know, those four key items you can have for, you know, real warrior survival or just weekend survival or whatever. But what kind of was your favorite part or key takeaway or something from the interview that you kind of enjoyed?
Well, something I really take away from it was a pleasantly sobering thought, which is you might have all these really sweet knives, and that's great. Believe me, I think so. But the really important thing is that you have one on you and that you've considered how you're willing to use it and how you would use it if necessary. So again, it's mindset. Everybody I talk to, even the designers, it all comes back to mindset. Are you willing to work through the problem and get to the solution? You know, if that's a survival situation, that knife has a whole lot to do with that. And when I say survival situation, Jim, we don't find ourselves in those frequently, but you know, you never know. You might get broken down by the side of the road on an interstate. Right. And that knife might come in handy for changing your tire for whatever it is.
Right.
So, I mean, to me, in my kind of cushy, suburban, modern day life, that is a survival situation. But if you're out there in the bush operating out there, it's all scalable in other
words. Well, as you pointed out in the interview, the knife is truly the first tool and just so many multiple uses for it, depending on your situation. But again, it all goes back to, as you said, that mindset and what you're willing to do and what you're prepared to do with it.
Yes, exactly.
Remind folks, theknifejunkie.com/YouTube is where you can catch all of Bob's videos, knife reviews, all kind of good stuff. But you've got a video coming out this week that's of kind of import for our listeners and a chance to win some stuff.
I will be putting up a giveaway video. I have some five Snaggletooth MFs. Those are the aftermarket pocket deployers. You may remember we had Rob Penna from Snaggletooth Tactical on the show not too long ago. And he gave me some of these to give out to you. So I'm going to be putting up a video, a giveaway video, and the first five commenters on that will receive these. Now, I have to let you know, on that podcast, Rob alluded to the new product he's creating. And I just received an email this morning that he is sending me a prototype to check out. And so I am really looking forward to that.
Absolutely.
I can't tell you what it is. You know, that information I'm sure will be put out there soon enough. So,
well, yeah, it'll be out there soon, and maybe we can try to persuade him to come back when that becomes public and talk about it. But if folks want to go back and listen to that episode with Rob, that was episode 16. So just go to theknifejunkie.com/16. That's theknifejunkie.com/16. And it'll take you right to the page that's got the audio player, and you can listen to the podcast right there. So episode 16 is Rob from Snaggletooth. All right, Bob, going to wrap it up another week on the Knife Junkie Podcast. Closing thoughts from you.
Just come back next week. There's going to be another great interview. That's how we roll now, Jim.
That's how the Knife Junkie operates.
All right. Well, thanks everybody for coming and have a fantastic week.
Thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and review at reviewthepodcast.com. For show notes for today's episode, additional resources, and to listen to past episodes, visit our website, TheKnifeJunkie.com. You can also watch our latest videos on YouTube at TheKnifeJunkie.com/YouTube. Check out some great knife photos on TheKnifeJunkie.com/Instagram, and join our Facebook group at TheKnifeJunkie.com/Facebook. And if you have a question or comment, email them to Bob@TheKnifeJunkie.com or call our 24/7 listener line at 724-466-4487, and you may hear your comment or question answered on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast.